Hello, I am Chauncey DeVega. You may recognize my voice from Ring of Fire Radio with Mike Papantonio, the BBC, Sirius XM, or the Tom Hartman Radio Show. And you may have read some of my essays at places like Salon and Alternate. I would like to thank all of you for listening to, downloading, tweeting, and sharing the eponymously named podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show.
And they ran a story by somebody named Chauncey DeVega.
Quote, I find black garbage pail kids, black conservatives, fascinating.
That's just unbelievable, you know.
He goes by the name of Chauncey DeVega.
You know, I've been called Uncle Tom, Oreo, sellout, shameless. But this is a new one.
Well, let's talk now to Chauncey DeVega.
As my man Chauncey DeVega of the blog We Are Respectable Negroes says,
I have author and blogger Chauncey DeVega here with us.
Hello there. You are listening to the eponymous podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show. You see, the grammar demon no longer has me in its possession. I'm also Blackula. That's a reference to my last Ring of Fire TV appearance last week for folks who didn't see it. Friends of the website, friends of Chauncey DeVega, boosters, haters, lovers, and friends will get the joke. Sitting here on a Thursday night, hearing my voice, it's a voice of contentment. Watch the New England Patriots win their opener. Tomorrow is September 11th, so always, you know, just a heavy moment, heaviness in the air. You think about all the possibilities to have America united with the world squandered by George Bush in the aftermath of that horrific event. One of those great historical what-ifs, isn't it? Osama bin Laden spent about $100,000 to cost the U.S., our citizens, us, and we, $4 trillion in an unnecessary war based on lies. And those war criminals, Cheney, Bush and company, Rumsfeld, and the other assorted goons who killed thousands of Americans, maimed and wounded, tens of thousands more likely, never mind the millions killed in the Middle East. Man, let me stretch for a moment. That was a little heavy. It is a great episode, fun episode, hinted at it last week. We'll be talking about conspiracy theories, September 11th, other assorted matters with Dr. Joe Uscinski, author of the really, really good book, American Conspiracy Theories. And as I said, fun, smart, interesting conversation. I'll give you a little more details about that later. This is my birthday week. Maybe that's responsible for the even, is it timbre or timbre, my voice? That was another Seinfeld joke. You know, I do like one Seinfeld wrestling observation per podcast episode. And I have decided that I'm going to perpetually be 36 years old as long as I can pull it off. So from now on, I am 36 whenever somebody asks me. So I always do my life assessment every birthday. And I think, you know, some ways I feel like I'm a lot farther ahead than I ever would have imagined. Other ways, if you had told me 3 years or 4 years ago, some of the other things going on in my life, at present, some good, some bad, mostly good. But that's life, isn't it? Ups and downs and travails and figuring stuff out. I guess that's how you become an artist and an adult. Live an interesting life. Have ups and downs, twists and turns. I probably wouldn't have believed them. I would have said, ooh, look at all this good stuff. And some of the other stuff, I've been like, what? Are you kidding me? So I know everything works out in its own way, in its own time. So I want to thank all of you, the friends, supporters, kind folks who download, share, tweet the eponymously named podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show. Also go to chaunceydevega.com. Indomitable/We Are Respectable Negroes. Folks are still holding on to that old name. And I keep saying I have to have a watermark made to put on the top header image, just WARN, and have it look all fancy so the folks who are in the know that history, and other folks will be like, oh, that's just a nice breakup in the page. So as I said, just sort of contemplating. As part of my life assessment every year, I think about my health. You got to monitor your health. And I think, again, I think my health in many ways is better than it was a year ago. That's good. I know for a fact certain things are much improved. And no, I'm not talking about my lingam in space, mountain. I don't want to jinx myself. I never had no problems in that department. Thank the Lord. Although there was that one time in 1988. Inside joke for those who get it. Actually, it wasn't 1988. It was 1998. And it lasted about 2 or 3 days. And talk about the panic that ensued. I'll give you a little story because, you know, we are friends here on the podcast. See, now I'm getting the energy. You know, when I get to tell a story, the energy picks up even when I'm being contemplative about my decrepitude, looking at my can of Coca-Cola. So you didn't hear this from me, but I'm sure there are folks who have done this. Maybe I'm just a coward. So I'd read about all the virtues of these magic pills that men can take for their dinguses. Not those pills you see late night TV pills. I mean, like, pills to help your dingus become angry. I'll leave it that way. The blue pill, you know, them pills. So in my infinite wisdom, because I wasn't going to tell my doctor this, I was just wanting to have him around, you know, I went online and I ordered some dingus pills. I ordered Cialis. And I went through a Canadian pharmacy. And I was all excited. I was like, yeah, boy. Got myself a pretty girlfriend. Got some liquor. I'm going to take one of these pills. And it's going to be Space Mountain X to the third to the fourth power. So the pills come in the mail. And in the meantime, I can't believe I'm sharing this story. What the heck? It's my birthday week. I'll do what I want to do. It's your birthday, Chauncey. It's your birthday, Chauncey. That's my Stevie Wonder impression. I get the pills, right? And I had started reading about them. And you could have all these heart attacks, color blindness, deafness, priapism. I guess it's priapism, priapism, where your dingus, your lingam is just erect. Where you could have all these complications with your dingus. The thing may swell up and have to go to the hospital. Now, I get these pills. I had a date planned that night. She was going to be in trouble, more so than usual. So I get the pills. And I'm reading this stuff again. And I'm looking at the box. So now my mind is just out of control. I'm like, these are from Canada. I had to go online and do some sort of fake interview process. I paid all this money for them. You know what I did? I ended up sending bad boys back. I got my money back. Called a credit card company. Said it was fraud. Reversed the charges. Because I talked myself out of it. Maybe that's just one of the things about life. Wisdom. And the joke being, I wouldn't want to be an older man and need some dingus pills. And then, because I had taken them when I was young, they wouldn't work. Yes, that's how my mind works. I know it doesn't make any sense. You know what else I want to share, since we're in the storytelling? My mother. Oh, and I want to thank the kind folks who did contribute to the Chauncey DeVega's Mama Dishwasher, rather, Washing Machine Fund. That's very nice of you. I mean that. All the folks who kindly threw some ducats in, a few folks who did it, that means a lot to me. I really, really, really appreciate it. That made me smile. So my mother always used to tell me, when you go to a department store, you need to wash the clothes before you wear them. Now, I don't tell her this. Sometimes I break that rule. But after what I saw this week, I am returning to that rule next time I go out and buy myself an outfit irregular at Burlington Coat Factory or even at Macy's or rarely at Nordstrom. I can't rationalize buying clothes at Nordstrom. They're too damn expensive. Macy's is the upper tier, my upper tier. So I'm at Burlington Coat Factory looking at some shoes and I had to use the toilet. So Burlington Coat Factory, folks who've heard my story about my knee, here's your knee update, still stagnant, 95% horizontal movement, only 80 something up and down stairs. And when I move my knee a certain way, I feel a sharp pain that goes from my knee down to my foot. I think something is seriously wrong. I make the appointment. I keep putting it off. I'm just so afraid I'm going to get in there. And the orthopedist is going to do some stuff and say, man, you done tore this knee up. You need to have surgery. And in my logic, being a Virgo, I'm figuring mind over matter. If I ignore it, it'll get better on its own. And it's not. So please send me some emails and inquire about my knee. Gently, Naga brother. So I'm in the bathroom, Burlington Coat Factory. And I'm running to the toilet. As I said, that's on my list. Burlington Coat Factory always got a clean toilet. And I'm in there with somebody else because they were cleaning it. So it's prime time to go. The nice little janitor lady, the clean and maintenance lady, had just finished. And I'm looking at this guy. He looking at me. You should never talk to strangers in the bathroom, by the way. Just don't do it. It's a silence zone. Silence zone. So this third guy runs in there, too, and he's got all these clothes. Now, he must have had a breakdown or some sort of emergency below the waist, because what he did don't make a bit of sense. Or maybe he's just a nasty, funky pig. Maybe he's a dirty butt. The guy takes all these new clothes. It was a suit jacket, two shirts. I was looking. I think a pair of jeans and some dress pants. Guess where this dirty bird puts the clothes? He doesn't have the good sense, because who knows what's going on with his guts, to hang the clothes up where they should be. So this man opens up the baby changing table that's on the wall that's poop and pee stained and puts clean clothes on it. I looked at him and I looked at the other guy. We're like, we couldn't believe it. I almost yelled at the dude. Like, what are you putting them clothes on that damn nasty diaper, funky, doo-doo, contaminated changing table? And you know, I bet that dirty bird went and picked them clothes up and either brought them home and wore them or put them back out there for some innocent person to put them on and try them on. I tell you, people lack home training. They really do. See, I need a Coca-Cola. Hold on. I need to take a sip after telling that story. Hold on. Woo! Scratch the flavor saver. I'm telling you, my spirits are picking up. Whenever I sit down to do the intro and outro to the podcast, my spirits pick up because I was a bit in the doldrums thinking about my birthday where I'll now be 36 or 37 forever, wondering what I've accomplished in life to this point. And see, I got to take that back. I'm sure folks who have birthdays know what I'm talking about. When you get into your 30s, 40s, you start comparing yourself to your peers. I'm doing so much better than some folk, not as well as others, certainly not exactly where I want to be in life, but things I feel like are turning the corner. I've been hinting at this. I feel like we're on a semi-truck. We all drive in the semi-truck together, folks. Friends and family, supporters of the website, and the eponymously named podcast named The Chauncey DeVega Show. And we're going down a hill at this point. And either that thing is going to skirt around that corner and we're going to be in the clear, like my favorite King of the Hill episode where they had that semi-truck and they're backing down the hill, or we're going to crash miraculously. And if we crash, you know what? We brush ourselves up and we get on off. That's what we do. We take that dirt off our shoulder and keep going. But hold on. Another flavor saver. Let me take a swig of this Coca-Cola. Hold on. Oh, that's good. Oh, that's good. So back to other matters. So, 9/11. I remember, I'm sure everybody for the most part, if you're a certain age, remember that morning. I guess it's like our Pearl Harbor. And I remember I was sleeping. And the phone keeps ringing. And I'm cursing because I did not get up early. It's not my thing. Don't be calling Chauncey DeVega before 11 a.m. But I know I stay up late, and that's just the nature of the world, you know, for me. So the phone rings, and it's my mother. I saw on the caller ID. Been ringing, and I'm half asleep. As I've fallen asleep, I think on the couch or something. And I'm like, Mom, what's going on? Somebody die. Because you know you get that call in the middle of the night. It's never good. Or you're woken up in the morning. It's either the wrong number or somebody's dead. My mother's like, are you watching the TV? We're under attack. I was like, under attack by what, Martians? What are you talking about? Because I'm half asleep, and I turn on the TV just as that second plane hits some Twin Towers, and you couldn't believe it. You couldn't believe it. Now, obviously, we'll get into this in the podcast in terms of conspiracy theories and alternative knowledge systems. Yes, I know about Operation Northwoods. Is that what it was called when they planned the whole thing in Cuba with dissidents to try to create a false flag operation? I know all that stuff. I grew up on Art Bell. But to sit there and watch it, it's just the unfathomable. And sometimes this comes up in my class. I tell students, they're like, well, that's impossible. That can never happen, whatever the example is. And I say, yeah, on September 10th, the average person didn't think a bunch of Al-Qaeda-affiliated jihadis were going to go and steal some planes with box cutters, and people are going to sit there and not fight back, and they're going to crash all these planes. September 12th, you knew it had happened. And that really was the day everything changed, wasn't it? You sort of think about America being a sociopathic country and the roots of our national derangement in so many ways. That really was it. We have been in a state of perpetual war. We have lost our goddamn minds. Never mind the torture. Never mind Gitmo. Never mind creating a situation abroad where you directly and indirectly kill millions of people. And then you sit there. I love when Cornel West said this. I remember C-SPAN when they covered it. My father was still alive in the kitchen. I happened to be home and Brother Cornell dropped that niggerization speech and it was on C-SPAN and he talked about America's been niggerized. See, that's my Cornell. He just go up the octave and had a little tss. He said, America's been niggerized by 9/11. And I said, wow. Talk about cogent thinking. White folks finally understand what it's like to be hated for who you are, which is, again, an oversimplification. It's about U.S. policy. They don't hate the American way of life. Our enemies hate American foreign policy and blowback. Folks know what blowback is, right? The unintended consequences of covert actions that were kept secret and hidden from the public that should have been anticipated, barring from Seymour Hersh. And I just never forget that day. I actually had a friend, you know, just doing some 9/11 storytelling, who actually survived. She worked in the towers and she survived the attack because she ate a bad breakfast burrito or something, or a McMuffin, and she was in the toilet on the train. She had to get off the train coming from Connecticut to New York, Metro North, and she said her butt was exploding and she was throwing up and she was on the toilet at a train station, jumped off the train. I think she may have been in Stanford or New Rochelle somewhere. And that's where she was. And everybody thought she was dead. And she was semi-delirious in the toilet. Man, the universe has a sense of humor, doesn't it? Sense of humor. So as is our tradition of sharing random things, actually, you always smile. I'm sure folks tune into the podcast sometimes. They're like, who is this crazy Negro up here telling these stories? And then is it the same man who does these interviews? Because I've gotten a few emails to that effect. And yes, it is. And I actually got a few emails I got to respond to. I always try to respond to people's emails. It has been a crazy time. I've had some really cool conversations for the podcast recorded this week and last week. Talked to a great, great, great guy. He will remain nameless. I don't like to give away the names of folks soon. Great guest. Was a writer on the TV show Benson, 227. Worked and wrote for the World Wrestling Federation. Also spoke to a senior scholar in the social sciences, sociologist, expert in social movement theory. We talked online, back and forth, did the interview, and he's just the very definition of what a senior scholar should be. And said some very, very kind words to say to me, which I was so appreciative of, and a lot of kind encouragement too. So that meant a lot to me too. So that put a smile on my face. And I think you guys are going to learn, the listeners, all of you are going to learn so much from his conversation about his new book about social movements and wealth inequality and race and the Tea Party phenomena. So that's coming up in a few weeks too. And then next week, doing a great conversation, I know it will be, with one of the foremost experts on Star Wars, something I know a lot about too. If you've watched the History Channel, my one claim to fame, my 2 second quote on the History Channel anniversary, special for Star Wars. So Star Wars is coming up too. So much good and wonderful stuff going on here. And I want to thank all of you for just getting behind the podcast and sharing it. And it's a weird thing. I was talking about that iTunes thing. I don't know how it works. So go from being in the top 50 sometimes, the top 20 to the top 200, whatever that means. But I do know people are listening because I get nice, kind emails. So something serious before we get to Joe Uscinski. As I said, our guest on this installment of the eponymously named podcast, known as the Chauncey DeVega Show. He's a professor, political scientist, new book out on conspiracy theories. And you listen to the podcast conversation, you'll pick up some interesting moments. And that's why I love sitting down with smart, interesting people doing smart, interesting things at the virtual bar. Because I don't always agree with my guests. And that's awesome. That's the life of the mind. That's the intellectual give and take. This is not an amen chorus. So we have a few moments there where I'm like, well, I could push back harder on this issue, especially around race and conspiracy theories. But no, you have smart and cool, nice folks who take the time. Let people talk and have that tension. And I think for me, my interview style, my conversational style, as folks who know follow the podcast, I don't do interviews. We have conversations. Is I'd like to just let people talk. And I like to listen. And I like to ask good questions. But my ultimate goal is, like, some people like to have like these contentious to and fro's. I'm not Charlie Rose school of thought. Just talk to people and let the listeners come to their own conclusions and be made curious about the guests, be made curious about their work and scholarship. Be like, you know what? I want to go and buy this book. But Joe Uscinski was so generous, so smart. But that's just a little hint for the careful listener about some moments of agreement and disagreement where some of you, I'm sure, will be like, why doesn't Chauncey say X, Y, and Z? Why isn't he saying this and that? Why isn't he pushing back harder? I'm like, no. We're two gentlemen at the bar, and we're having some online conversation. So I was so happy when I listened to the podcast because I wasn't sure how that was going to come across, but it made for good listening, at least in my ear. At least, and I was there. So sometimes you could be your own worst critic, but it was really, really, really good. So I was alluding to earlier, on occasion, I like to read and I like to share important things, things that I think resonate with the moment. And again, thinking about 9/11, and I always mess up the gentleman's name, philosopher, scholar, man with a starred career many times over, Slavoj Žižek, you can email me. I went to a public school, so sometimes I mispronounce words. Just like I had that grammar demon that was kicked out of me, but Slavoj Žižek had a seminal essay in 2002. About this endless war on terror and the wars that he foresaw forthcoming, the idea of a war on terror and the horrible place it would lead us to, because you can't have a war on a tactic. Never mind who gets to decide who the terrorists are and who's doing the terrorizing. I have a lot of people around the world will say America is the biggest terrorist state in existence in terms of our thuggery, our brutality, killing innocent people. I think the CIA admitted that they do these drone strikes and they know they're killing dozens of people for one quote unquote enemy, wasting millions of dollars to kill somebody who's a dirt farmer. I tell you, talk about skewed national priorities. I was reading also, too, there's about ISIS. Did you know, according to some calculations, it's $2 million per bomb in an airstrike dropped on these folks driving around in pickup trucks and Humvees that we gave them? Think of, you know, this is my Dwight Eisenhower military industrial complex moment. Think about all the good that money could do here instead of giving it to the ironmongers to be wasted. Think about all that good. And again, that can be traced back to 9/11, of course, and certainly the think tanks and others that were looking for a pretext to go to Iraq to remake the Middle East in a failed effort to try to unsettle standing governments, create chaos and disorder that they thought would be favorable to American interests. Clearly, it was not into Israeli interests. All back to that day. All back to that day. The madness of that day. So one of my favorites, as I said, essay Slavoj Žižek, read a little bit of that. Just to meditate upon his prescient observations that who would have thought 14 years, we've basically been fighting four World War IIs against something vaguely called terrorism in the Middle East against groups broadly defined as Al-Qaeda, now ISIS / ISIL. So I'm going to put on my reading voice. It is melodic and beautiful, isn't it? And I tell you, I can put people to sleep with this voice, but don't you fall asleep. You best wake up. So this is from Žižek's Are We in a War? And Do We Have an Enemy? After the collapse of the communist states, which provided the figure of the Cold War enemy, the Western imagination entered a decade of confusion and inefficiency, looking for suitable schematizations of the enemy, sliding from narco-cartel bosses, from the succession of warlords of so-called rogue states, Saddam, Noriega, Idid, Milosevic, without stabilizing itself in one central image. Only with 11 of September did this imagination regain its power, by constructing the image of bin Laden, the Islamic fundamentalist, and Al-Qaeda, his invisible network. What this means, furthermore, is that our pluralistic and tolerant liberal democracies remain deeply Schmitzian. They continue to rely on enemy Einbildungskraft to provide them with the appropriate figure to render visible the invisible enemy. Far from suspending the binary logic friend and or enemy, the fact that the enemy is defined as the fundamentalist opponent of pluralistic tolerance merely adds a reflexive twist to it. This renormalization has involved the figure of the enemy undergoing a fundamental change. It is no longer the evil empire, i.e. another territorial entity, but an illegal, secret, almost virtual worldwide network in which lawlessness and criminality coincides with fundamentalist ethico-religious fanaticism. And since this entity has no positive legal status, the new configuration entails the end of international law, which, at least from the onset of modernity, regulated relations between states. When the enemy serves as the quilting point, the Lacanian point de capitan of our ideological space, it is in order to unify the multitude of our actual political opponents. Thus, Stalinism in the 1930s constructed the agency of imperialist monopoly capital to prove that fascists and social democrats are twin brothers, the left and right hand of monopoly capital. Thus, Nazism constructed the plutocratic Bolshevik plot as the common agent threatening the welfare of the German nation. Kapitänage is the operation by means of which we identify and construct a sole agency that pulls the strings behind a multitude of opponents. Exactly the same holds for today's war on terror, in which the figure of the terrorist enemy is also a condensation of two opposed figures, the reactionary fundamentalist and the leftist resistant. The title of Bruce Barcott's article in the New York Times Magazine on 7 of April, From Tree Hugger to Terrorist, says it all. The real danger isn't from the rightist fundamentalists who are responsible for the Oklahoma bombing, and in all probability for the anthrax scare, but the Greens, who have never killed anyone. The ominous feature underlying all these phenomena is the metaphoric universalization of the signifier terror. The message of the latest American TV campaign against drugs is, when you buy drugs, you provide money for the terrorists. Terror is thus elevated to become the hidden point of equivalence between all social evils. How, then, are we to break out of this predicament? Doesn't that sum up the madness? You create an enemy, you have a world of binaries, you go after quote-unquote terrorists, you need the enemy to give you a sense of meaning and importance, and you violate all these standing norms and bargains of international relations and modernity along the way. And then, inevitably, you turn that monster against your own citizens. Surveillance society, austerity, neoliberalism, culture, cruelty, all that meanness, all that sociopathic behavior directed at the enemy abroad is inevitably directed at the quote-unquote enemy at home. And then what happens when you run out of enemies? Or do you ever cease to run out of enemies? Talk about a paradox. Whew, let me exhale there. Man, that's Žižek. Boy, he got a lot going on. He's a smart man. He's a real smart man. Much to contemplate in this episode of the eponymously named podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show. So, Joe Uscinski, American conspiracy theories. So we talk about 9/11, of course. We talk about and share, and he does some great teaching here about alternative knowledge systems and the idea that the conspiracy is a construct. And how does the construct of the conspiracy, how does it mobilize people? How does it capture their imaginations? How does it work as a type of cognitive map that they use to orient themselves relative to their culture, to each other, to politics? And Dr. Uscinski makes, you know, he's an empiricist, so he's got the data, which is wonderful. This isn't just reasoning in a vacuum. This is rigorous empirical work. And there's a whole community of scholars now in the social sciences, philosophy, humanities, and elsewhere who are studying conspiracy theories. The idea being that both the left and the right have conspiracy theories, right? And he gives us a great working definition of conspiracy theory. So again, he's an empiricist, social scientist. And then we proceed from that definition. But one of his claims that, as I said, I found very provocative was that folks on both the left and the right believe in equal percentages in conspiracy theories. But it's just the type of conspiracy that the group that's out of power holds about the group in power. One of the examples we talked back and forth about is I said, listen carefully. You sort of hear my playing with the idea and trying to push a little bit. Is that conservatives believe that Obama is these birther racist, white supremacist types, Alex Jones, Rush Limbaugh, Fox News, mainstreaming of hate and conspiranoid fantasies that go all the way back probably to the 50s, if not earlier, that Obama was not born in this country as a Muslim. God forbid, as though there aren't Muslim Americans, or he was born in Indonesia in the most elaborate plot I've ever heard of. And that an equal percentage of self-identified, I guess, liberals or liberals or progressives believe that Bush stole the election in the year 2000. Well, I think that evidence is a lot stronger for the belief in the latter than the former, given all the shenanigans with the voting, the hanging chads, the Supreme Court that intervenes and acts outside of what its role in contemporary politics should be, which is to be apolitical to the degree possible and to be stewards as opposed to activists in the worst sense. And the data, it was a fun little to and fro there in terms of saying, okay, how do we decide about the content and the reasonableness of the claim and how that goes in to assessing it? Because as you and I know, friends and fans of the website, folks who listen to it, folks who are interested in politics more generally, historians and others who know the real deal, we know that conspiracies are probably a lot more common than many would want to admit, especially for those of us who exist outside of power, the other side of the color line, the poor, the working class. In many ways, our existence here is a conspiracy. The conspiracy of the slave trade and white supremacy, the Klan, racial terrorism, et cetera, et cetera. But it all comes down to definitions. And that's why I really enjoyed the conversation with Dr. Uscinski. It all comes down to definitions and frameworks. So the next segment of our podcast, American Conspiracy Theories, on the September 11th anniversary or day before anniversary of the eponymously named podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show.
This land is your land, and this land is my land. From California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters, this land was made for you and me. As I went a-walking that ribbon of highway, and I saw above me that endless skyway, I saw below me that golden valley. This land was made for you and me.
So Alex Jones, you know, he's mentioned me on his website before. And you know how their operation is, you know, part of the right-wing media, the echo chamber, where they sort of have their talking point of the day or their hit piece of the day. Mm-hmm. They're upset about the piece I wrote about the church burnings. And that's something we can talk about, too, because that's fascinating in the sense that in the African-American community and others, there's sort of a narrative to be like, yeah, that's a conspiracy that black churches are burning, and it's no coincidence that it's after Dylann Roof's massacre. Mm-hmm. But in a lot of ways, it's confirmation bias. I'm just sort of looking at the data. So I wake up, and I got these emails, and I'm like, huh. Why is Alex Jones sending me these emails, right? Folks saying, oh, did you see? So he has a thing he's doing now on his website where he has his quote-unquote news segment every day where he's pontificating about a race war in America and how the elites are creating the environment for a race war, and black and brown social justice types, I guess like me, I guess I'm part of that cabal, and the global 1% and the white supremacists are all conspiring to have a race war. And any discussions about Dylann Roof are a false flag operation, because apparently Dylann Roof didn't really kill all these people, or he killed them and he had assistance, but from parties that we don't know about. It's standard boilerplate stuff. It's funny, but it's just, you know, but it's also disturbing for what it says about our political environment.
You know, on that, it does not shock me that there are conspiracy theories out there about the shootings. in the church, and because every shooting that happens, there's always some thought that, hey, this might be a false flag operation, and there's something behind it. If you go back to, you know, Sandy Hook or the one in Aurora prior to that, there were people who thought that false flag operation to take away guns, and now it's some sort of race false flag operation. You know, and this brings up a really interesting point about conspiracy theories. The question that often comes up is, are they all bad and are they corrosive to society, or do they present some good? Because theories like this seem really abhorrent, right? Like the idea that, you know, a bunch of kids get killed and, you know, we know what happened, we know who the shooter was, and somebody comes out and says it's a conspiracy, you know, or the kids didn't really die, or that it was actors in the news media or something. It sounds awful. But there is some value in this sort of stuff. I mean, we have a media that isn't always as skeptical of corporations and the government and other sources of power as it should be. Because of that, some of that responsibility gets passed off onto conspiracy theorists and conspiracy theories to kind of provide that, you know, you might call it a one-eyed jack person, but that person who's just going to be overly skeptical at times, and even if it does sound at times awful, they're still doing something of a service.
Point about the fourth estate is a great one. I mean, what is it now with media consolidation? Three corporations that own most of the media outlets? And we can make a list, never mind sort of thinking about, you know, Chomsky's work about sort of the manufacturing of consent, or sort of I've certainly encountered, I'm sure you probably have in other ways, sort of the narrow space for approved public discourse. But how do we sort of draw a line between healthy skepticism and irresponsibility?
It's been 5 years that I've been working on this, and I'll probably be working on it another 10, and by the time I'm done, I probably won't have an answer to that question. You know, there's a lot of philosophers working on conspiracy theories, and that's something that they spend a lot of time thinking about. At what point is across the line from healthy to unhealthy? And I don't know. And even if there is a line, what do you do about it? I mean, if we can identify some conspiracy theories as very unhealthy and corrosive, what do you do? I mean, do you take away the free speech rights of people who want to discuss those conspiracy theories? I mean, that would lead us to an incredibly dark place.
That's right. I mean, it's Orwellian. And you mentioned philosophers, you know, writing about conspiracy theories. How has the book been received by political scientists? Because I'm thinking about, it's a, you know, we would say in the business, sort of a sexy idea, right? And you have good methodology, and it's a question, you know, Hofstadter wrote about conspiracy theories, right, the paranoid style, but he didn't do sort of the empirical work that you and your colleague have done. How have folks responded to it?
Very well. I mean, depends who you ask. If you read the reviews on Amazon, there are some people who are convinced I'm part of a corporate conspiracy to shut down all debate. I mean, there are other folks who are more socially scientific, and they actually like the work. Our work fits in with a lot of the work that's been getting done over the last 8 years. So it was around 2007, 2008, that social scientists, mostly psychologists at the beginning, started getting into the topic and trying to figure out why people believe in conspiracy theories and what's driving it. You know, so the previous work had dealt a lot with historical accounts and cultural criticism and whatnot, but it was around 8 years ago that people started doing, you know, more data-driven work, experiments and survey data and whatnot. So that's where my book falls in, is sort of into that empirical tradition. And it's done very well. I mean, the topic has taken off in political science and in other social science disciplines. This last March, I hosted a conference down here at the University of Miami on conspiracy theory research, and we had 50 researchers. Part of it was the draw of the topic. The other part was getting to go to Miami in March, which is not that tough of a sell, but it was an incredibly fruitful conference. And one of the things that we found out is that across disciplines and across different academic approaches, there's a wide variance in how scientists are looking at this and the sorts of different questions that they ask. And I'll give you one good example of this. There's a lot of political scientists that talk about conspiracy theories not as conspiracy theories in the sense that they might be true or might be false, but in terms of, you know, these are myths, these are untruths, these are lies, why do people believe these things? So it's almost a closed door on truth. Philosophers, on the other hand, they walk into that question much more openly and say they might be true, they might not be true. How can we distinguish true from false? You know, what are the characteristics of conspiracy theories that, that would lead us to think that they might be true or false? So it was a great learning experience for everyone to kind of share ideas and approaches. If anyone was going to look at academia and say, well, they're all anti-conspiracy theory or they'll have one mind on this, it's simply not true.
Because I'd also think, too, I'm sure you probably had some presenters who've done work on this. And are the papers available online from the conference?
Not from the conference, but all the authors have, that I invited have a lot of published work on the topic. And if you go to Google Scholar and you just type in conspiracy theory and then limit the search to the last 7 or 8 years, you'll find pretty much everything everyone has written.
But I was also thinking about, you know, I would think that researching conspiracy theories from the social scientific perspective would also lead one to look at social network analysis, social network theory, how these ideas circulate. And as you pointed out, the epistemological issue is really fascinating, too. Like, philosophers, based on their training and based on their disciplinary concerns, are going to proceed from different priors than social scientists or political scientists, depending on their training. So I can imagine it was a really, really rich conversation. I mean, what were some of the other high points from the conference? Some, you know, pleasant surprises or things that folks had just not thought about?
One of the really good talks we had was from Brendan Nyhan, who is a political scientist at Dartmouth. And he gave a lunchtime keynote about how redacted information can drive people to believe in conspiracy theories.
Absolutely.
So you think about when the government puts out a document and then they take a black marker and, you know, remove all the nouns and verbs and leave you with nothing. What's the effect of that? You know, when he did experiments showing people redacted and unredacted documents, was that the redacted documents were driving conspiracy beliefs. And what that tells us is, you know, sometimes the government will release documents just to say they did or they're under pressure to do so, but they redact everything. That actually makes matters worse, because if people thought that the government was up to no good before, now they'll definitely think that something's afoot. An interesting point that he made was that they're just redacting, the government now is redacting so much information that it just doesn't need to redact. And there were some examples of this shown where, you know, there was a document that a congressman had just made some handwritten notes on, and they redacted the handwritten note, so it makes it look like there's some secret dealing going on, when in fact, when they removed the redaction, it just had a swear word from the congressman that said, this is bullshit. There was nothing there that was a government secret or whatnot. It was just mundane stuff that they deleted out. But the end result of that can be very bad.
I've read about this. I don't know if the practice, I would assume under Obama, given that administration's obsession with secrecy, clamping down on whistleblowers, that, and you can correct me if this is, you know, inaccurate or it's, you know, a false memory on my part, that the White House, and I don't know if congressmen and senators have this ability, but when a president gives a speech or a briefing, for example, or one of the spokespeople do, that they can then go back after the fact and change the text of the speech or the briefing.
I don't know if that's true, and I don't know what that would get them now, because
you'd have the video records.
Yeah, you have video records, but I guess if they misspeak a word or something and they just want to make the record clear, then that's something they could do. But, I mean, obviously if you take that too far, it becomes very 1984-ish. Like, we're going to change what I said yesterday, so it's true.
Now I remember where I got the memory from. As I said, you know, your book is so valuable, number one, as I said, for the empirical work, but also as someone like myself who's a self-described ghetto nerd, you grew up listening to Art Bell and Coast to Coast AM and reading the Weekly World News and wondering about Bat Boy while I worked at the convenience store, saying, man, this is just great stuff. And then you actually start, you know, with the birth of the internet, right? And as it expanded and we went from dial-up to actually being able to actually use it practically. I mean, just going online and reading about these conspiracy theories. And I have really not encountered one. And we have to define what a conspiracy theory is, too. I mean, terms are important. It's just really fascinating that many of these, you know, the most popular ones really don't hold up under any critical or strict scrutiny. But how do you disprove a negative?
Before we get into definitions, this is the important thing, is that it's very difficult to convince somebody of something they don't want to believe.
Right.
And evidence doesn't really matter. I mean, we all like to think that our beliefs are based on sound reasoning and the best available evidence, and we all like to think that we're rational and our opinions come about because they're true.
Mm-hmm.
And everything we believe because it's true. But no, that's just not the case. I mean, all of us believe things because there's a lot of psychological stuff going on between us, inside of us. So go back to when we're young. I mean, we get our political opinions, our political worldviews, our ideologies from our socializing experiences, which comes from when we're a kid and a teenager and a young adult. And all those things come inside of us and create who we are. So most of the action in our opinions isn't, hey, you're given a new piece of information and then you react to it rationally. No. So you're given a new piece of information and that information is judged based upon your existing predispositions, which you've had since, you know, you were very young. If I was to give the same piece of information to a Republican and a Democrat, they're going to evaluate it very differently. So if I gave the current jobs numbers to a Republican, he'd say, see, this shows how terrible Obama is. And if I gave the same numbers to a Democrat, they'd say, this shows that how good Obama is. Same information, incredibly different interpretation. Why is the interpretation different? Because inside of them is, you know, is housed all those mechanisms that determine how they're going to view evidence and information and whatnot. So, and it's the same thing with conspiracy theories. You know, good evidence is in the eye of the beholder. And we could bang our head all day saying, oh my God, I have evidence to show that Bush blew up 9/11 or that Obama was born in Kenya. you know, and the people who believe those things believe that the evidence is on their side. Just as the people who don't believe those things believe that the evidence is on their side too.
I mean, the rational choice folks who think about human decision making as we're walking around as human calculators would likely be frustrated by our observation. But I mean, you're spot on because we have all the emerging research about brain structure and cognition, the malleability of memory, as you said, you know, political socialization in the home through religious organizations, other networks and so on. And I was reading the other day about memories and how the vast majority of our memories from childhood, I think psychologists or neuroscientists are saying, most of our memories before the age of 6 are false. And we're actually just basically creating false memories from the stories we've been told about our childhood. All right. So, I mean, when you actually think about the nature of memory and reality, and then you think about politics, but how do we actually define terms? So I'll give you a story in terms of thinking about what is a conspiracy theory. So I was at the barber the other day, and I was talking to his brother at the barbershop. And he was talking about there's a conspiracy to lock up black men and black women, and white supremacy, there's a conspiracy. And, of course, he had to talk about the Willie Lynch letter, which is another classic. And I'm sitting there, because, you know, the barbershop is a place for conversation and dialogue, part of the black public sphere, subaltern space, and so on. And I turned to him, and I said, well, that's not a conspiracy. That's called big business. And this is called, you know, this is sort of the neoliberal biopolitics at work. I mean, you go and you incentivize locking people up. It's a moral hazard. I don't know if that's a conspiracy. I think it's morally and ethically reprehensible when you give people incentives to lock people up and treat them unfairly, but I don't think it's a conspiracy. So, I mean, like, how would you define a conspiracy?
See, you're getting into a very gray area right there. So before I give you a definition, it's very tough to know what is and isn't a conspiracy and what is and isn't a conspiracy theory because the example you give, I mean, yes, you have a group of people who are doing something that's pretty bad, and they're benefiting from it, and a lot of what they're doing is taking place in secret. So you have almost the definition of conspiracy right there, right? It's different than Watergate, and it's different than Iran-Contra. You know, and perhaps the only difference is that the network of people is a little more loose, and it's not always clear what the prime directive is, right? So imagine the players in that conspiracy theory. You have legislators who want to get criminals off the street, right? And they think they're doing the right thing by passing drug laws and stiffening sentencing, okay? And then they might be in league with people who build prisons, you know, but not in a conspiracy way like, hey, I'll pass this bill so you can make more money, but more in a they're chummy with each other. And then you have law enforcement get involved and say, you know, we really like having all the business of stealing money from black people.
And poor people in general with this asset forfeiture.
Yes, we like stealing money. And the legislature says, well, you know, the legislature doesn't see it as, hey, we're going to steal money from black people or from poor people. But, hey, if law enforcement gets more money to buy stuff that they need, that's a good thing. And if we're taking money from criminals, that's great. So you have this whole thing build up, and none of it was completely planned out by anyone. No one is pulling the strings. But it's just this kind of odd network. And when they all get together and start doing their thing, you wind up with this very bad outcome that almost looks like a conspiracy. But in terms of definitions, our definition of conspiracy and conspiracy theory is this. So a conspiracy is you have a group of conspirators who are working in secret to get some sort of benefit for themselves at the expense of the common good. Okay, so Watergate, Iran-Contra, Tuskegee are all things that fall into conspiracy. And conspiracies are true. We know that they happened. We know that they existed. In the case of Watergate, Nixon admitted to it. The other conspirators admitted to it. People went to jail. There were open hearings. The evidence is out there. It's real. Conspiracy theory differs from that in that it's an accusation of a conspiracy. So it might be true and it might not be true. It could be one or the other. We just don't know. Now, the people who believe in a conspiracy theory won't call it a conspiracy theory. They'll call it a conspiracy. They'll say it's conspiracy fact. You know, Bush did blow up 9/11. There's no question here. Or Obama was definitely born in Indonesia. There's no question here. This is fact. But that's to them. So again, that's where we get into the philosophical, epistemological aspect of it, and is what is truth? And that's very difficult to know because a lot of people think that what they think is true and what the other guy thinks is false and just theory. I can't avoid it, but in my empirical work, I do. And the way that I avoid that sort of debate is to just say, you know, we want to know why people believe things. And because of that, it doesn't matter if it's true or not. We just want to know why. Just the same way, if I want to know why somebody's Jewish or Christian or Buddhist or whatnot, I don't have to know which of those religions is true. I don't have to know who the right God is. And I don't have to know what the proper religious text or interpretation of that text is. I don't have to know that. I can still study why people believe in the religious things they do without knowing which one's true. Same thing with conspiracy theories, that I can study why people believe in them without having to know if they're precisely true or not.
I was thinking about the birtherism example, right? So we began by alluding to the idea that, well, healthy cynicism is a good thing, right? Especially in an era of, you know, concision and corporate-controlled media and propaganda, right? Not that propaganda is new, certainly, but the sophisticated ways and the multiple ways that can now be delivered by the mass media and the internet, et cetera. But using birtherism, and in terms of, you know, sort of thinking about people's decision-making processes, was that just driven by a combination of racial animus, if not overt racism, symbolic politics, and sort of the right-wing echo chamber that, and here's my concern, and I wear my politics on my sleeve, as someone who's concerned about the common good, that Fox News, and I put that in quotation marks, right, in scary quotes, right, we can debate if it's even a news operation, given that it actually harms its viewers based in terms of, you know, all the research we've read about folks who watch Fox News actually know less about empirical reality than people who don't watch the news at all. But let's call them news for the moment. Was that just a perfect storm in terms of a conspiracy theory? I mean, because on the surface, it's patently absurd, but if you already have these priors, and again, this gets us back to thinking about the Fourth Estate, and that we would so muck up the public works, and we're dealing with a broken economy, wars, and all these other things, that this would even be an issue of concern, largely driven by one news network, and the other ones pick up on it, right, because I'd say they're equally responsible in that way, and the internet. I mean, how do we make sense of birtherism?
You know, one thing that I try to do as a public opinion scholar is to not look at each opinion in a vacuum.
Yeah.
And that is to try to look at opinions, you know, with broader, richer theories and put them in context. You know, you can look at that and say, oh my God, it's racism. But racism doesn't really explain conspiracy theories generally. Mm-hmm. I mean, racism wouldn't explain JFK. It wouldn't explain Trutherism. It wouldn't explain most conspiracies.
Mm-hmm.
So I kind of toss that out as a explanation of birtherism. I mean, I looked at data over the course of 100 years. And what we found was that over time, the people who get accused of being the conspirator are the people who are in power. So that prominent conspiracy theories tend to follow the balance of power in the country. So when Democrats take office, Democrats are accused of being the conspirator. When Republicans are in office, they are the ones who are accused of being the conspirator. So, yes, Obama came in and people thought that he was a communist and a Muslim and he was illegally usurping power because he was born somewhere else. But that's a very natural and normal thing. And even more natural and normal given, you know, how he came to office. He came out of nowhere, got a huge vote in the Electoral College, then had control of both houses of Congress. So he became incredibly powerful overnight. So power shifted from Republicans having power under Bush, then it shifted. And, of course, those people were, Republicans were scared, naturally, like anyone would be, just as Democrats were when George W. Bush took power. And then they had conspiracy theories about George W. Bush, which were just as popular as the ones that attacked Barack Obama. Sometimes I think conspiracy theories are an opportunity to reach out to the other side and to understand their fears and what they're afraid of. Because they don't always make it clear, but if you think that Obama is a communist and a bad guy and he's part of some clandestine plot, well, that says you're afraid of what's going to happen in the future, and you're afraid of what future policy is going to be, and you feel like your voice has been left out. And I think we can have sympathy for those feelings, that in a democratic society, we shouldn't just plow over political minorities, and that we should make sure that there's a space for them to express themselves and to have say, and that way they don't feel like they've been, that they're just at the whim of whoever's in power at the moment. That goes the same for both sides.
But thinking about the social context, just pushing back a little bit, so a little give and take here, for Obama's election, because if we're thinking about the social context, we can't overlook the fact that he's the first president who happens to be black. He's not a black president. We can parse that one. And then thinking about changing demographics, right, sort of, you know, the rise in talk about symbolic racism and modern colorblind racism, but we've also seen a spike on the far white right, and even some would say, I've written a piece on Alternet, you know, sort of riffing off some recent scholarship on this, how in the Republican Party, conservatism and racism are now, unfortunately, one and the same thing in a lot of ways, in terms of sort of the Southern strategy and pandering to white racial resentment. How can we bracket out those sort of real phenomena that they're empirically demonstrable from the penchant or the habit for some to be attracted to these conspiracy theories about Obama and birtherism? Is it easy to sort of separate them? Or, I mean, we have to talk about all of them together? Because that would be my suggestion. I mean, I don't understand. I don't think we can theorize birtherism and try to understand it without understanding race.
I mean, would you make the argument that if Barack Obama was white, that there would be no conspiracy theories about him?
Oh, I think there would be conspiracy theories.
It's just they would be different. You probably wouldn't have the birther thing, right? But you might have communism,
yep.
You know, and you might have some other things there too, different things. So if race is playing a role, it's not in driving conspiracy theories. Maybe it's driving the content of those conspiracy theories.
And that's what I wanted to clarify, because, I mean, even thinking about McCain, let's say McCain was elected. I mean, wasn't he born in the Panama Canal Zone? And folks, I'm sure, would have mined that to say he was illegitimate somehow, because I actually thought that came up in a vote, and they had to, you know, either had to have a resolution or a discussion about his eligibility.
It's come up again because of Ted Cruz, and that he was born in Canada, but to an American mother, I think. So, but there have been other candidates throughout history that were born somewhere else to American parents, sometimes on military bases, because they have birthright citizenship because of the parent.
That's right.
You know, there's an argument that they do count under the Constitution as natural born, even though they weren't born on soil. But, sure, I mean, people are going to take what they observe to create their conspiracy theories, which express fears that they have and what they're thinking about that person. So you couldn't say that a president was born in Kenya if they're lily white, right?
That's right.
So,
although there are plenty of white people born in Kenya. Yeah.
So is it the case that it's racism driving it or just opportunity? I don't know. I mean, a lot of people on the left like to say, oh, you know, they're all racist and this birther thing shows it. But, I mean, is it worse to say that the president was born in a different country than it is to say that a president purposely murdered 3,000 of his own people? Is it worse? I mean, that's a judgment that your listeners can make for themselves, but it's difficult, you know, to point fingers at the Republicans and say, well, you know, 30 or 40% of them believe that Barack Obama was born in another country, so it shows they're crazy. But an equal number on the Democrat side believe that Bush purposely murdered 3,000 of his own citizens.
And you've looked at the data. I mean, this is why I love, you know, sitting down trying to be a good social scientist here looking at the data. Because there, you know, one of my things I just find so annoying is we very often treat things that are known knowns as unknown unknowns. And if you just took 5 seconds, channeling Rumsfeld there, to do a little research, you may actually find an answer. So what does the data actually tell us about political ideology and party ID in terms of people's propensity to believe conspiracy theories? I mean, was Hofstadter right in terms that there are certain political personality types more often are more likely on the right during certain time periods to believe these things, and maybe it shifts to the left, or we brand as the left during other time periods? What does the data tell us?
The data tells us that between the two parties, you know, conspiracy worldviews are about even.
Wow.
It's about even. So it's not, you can't look at the right and say they're a bunch of crackpot conspiracy theorists. The left are just as guilty. They're just as guilty of it. And that's okay, because conspiracy theories are just part of the human condition. And there's nothing necessarily wrong with it. You know, we hear a lot in the media that, you know, it's the right that's a bunch of, you know, conspiracy cranks and whatnot. But they tend to overlook oftentimes the conspiracy theories that are closer to home, those ones that are held very closely by their own side. And so you can compare the amount of Republicans that believe in birther theories to the amount of Democrats that believe in truther theories, and it's about even. You can compare underlying conspiracism. We can measure people's worldview, how much do they think the world is run by conspiracy theories, and then compare that to partisanship. Shows us that the two parties are just about even. You can compare conspiracy theories about election fraud. You know, 36% of Republicans believe that there was fraud in the 2008 election, but 37% believe there was of Democrats believe there was fraud in the 2004 election. Almost even. You know, so there is no big difference. The only difference is in who they accuse of conspiring and what specific conspiracy theories they believe in.
So we have, as you say, I mean, and this is some great clarification there, right? So just to make sure I got it right. So both sides have a propensity in equal amounts, roughly, to believe in conspiracy theories. It's just the substance and the type of conspiracies they believe in is different. How then do we evaluate the substance of those claims? So plain devil's advocate. Some would say that 2004, it's a Fox News trick, some would say, suspicions about 2004 based on the Supreme Court's intervention and the recount make a hell of a lot more sense than any claims that the election was stolen or there was fraud with Obama when he won by an overwhelming plurality of the American public. I mean, how do we then evaluate the content of the claims or the evidence?
You don't.
As you said earlier, like, yep, they're going to believe what they're going to believe.
And of course, the people on the left would say, well, you know, if we believe that, you know, when the Republicans win that it's fraudulent, well, it's based on good evidence. But when the other side thinks that we cheated, well, that's just crazy talk.
Mm-hmm.
But both sides say that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's very difficult to get away from, because everybody believes that the conspiracy theories that their side holds are based on evidence, and they're, if not completely true, mostly true, or at least not irrational. Or if they are irrational, then they're only held by a tiny fringe. But it's simply not true. It's just not, you know, it's just not true. Both sides are equally guilty on this, and both sides have equal grasp of evidence.
Mm-hmm. How do you, again, another interesting concept here, or important one that's sort of drilled into our heads as social scientists, sociologists, and others, is this idea of legitimacy and how we sort of think about the state or government or elites as having legitimate power, especially in democracy. So, like, can we use a belief in conspiracy theories or the percentage of the public that hold these beliefs as a barometer for a belief in legitimacy? I mean, are they proxies for one another? So what is society, I'll say, like, you know, oligarchs in Saudi Arabia or Syria or maybe even, you know, Latin and South America where you had people being disappeared, right, and executed by the state by death squads. Are those societies more prone to conspiracy theories because the folks there, the people, have less of a belief in the legitimacy of those governments, whereas the U.S. or other democracies would have fewer conspiracy believers because of a higher level of legitimacy? Or is it both or neither? Or is it really, really muddy?
Well, that's a good question. I mean, in some countries in this world, I mean, the government is run through conspiracy. You know, it's corruption and backroom dealing. And if you were to be that person on the street who didn't believe in the conspiracy theory, you'd be the idiot. You would be naive. You know, so in those circumstances, believing in conspiracy theories is completely rational, and it's based on the evidence, because that's what's going on there. That's what it is. In the United States, it's a very different picture, though, because occasionally we will find evidence of wrongdoing. And what happens is that it gets ferreted out. People know who did it. It winds up in the news. Maybe the outcome isn't what we want it to be. Maybe the wrongdoers don't always go to prison. But when we find conspiracies in government or in corporations, they get exposed. People don't like that, and they don't say that's how things ought to be. They say, that's awful. We don't want that behavior to go on, and we want to figure out how to end it. So in that sense, the U.S. is very much an anti-conspiracy country. As crazy as that might sound to some people, you know, if you put on the internet and, you know, you have your Facebook feed filled with all sorts of articles like the 10 craziest conspiracy theories or 5 kooky conspiracy theories that people believe about something that just happened, you might think, oh my God, the whole country is going to the mental asylum. But it's just not true. In our country, we're raised to really trust authority figures. We believe in the system. We might believe there are some problems in it. But in general, you know, most people are socialized to buy in, and they don't reject it, and they don't think that there's a conspiracies behind every corner.
Mm-hmm.
Now, some people do, but that's not the majority opinion of America.
And that also gets us to, and you talk about this in the book and then also in some of your interviews, about how conspiracy theories can also be used sort of as a measure, as you said, for healthy cynicism, but also for how individual groups are related to power. Right. So if you're part of the out group or you're part of a group where the conspiracy is real, you damn well better believe in it because you have all this evidence. And I was thinking, you know, you mentioned the Tuskegee syphilis experiment. I mean, I'm thinking about all those examples over time where you heard about a phenomena or an issue of public concern. I'll pick an obvious one. When I was growing up in the 80s, the big thing was the CIA put LSD in the water and they were using chemical and weapons and nerve gas in the subways to test it during the Cold War. I'm probably sure you remember this stuff, too.
3 Nights of the Grateful Dead in Chicago, so maybe they did do that.
It's funny you mentioned that. I was joking with a friend. I was downtown stuck in that, and I said, man, consider myself a pragmatist with left leanings on some issues, right leanings on others. But I said, I felt like Barry Goldwater or Nixon cursing the dirty hippies. Man, I was like, all the dirty hippies, they've overrun the city. There's 70,000 of them. Get out the fire hoses.
Well, if those are the dirty hippies, those are the cleanest dirty hippies ever, because I was watching it on pay-per-view, and everyone was showered and probably staying at the... You know,
I was going to say, to be able to afford $5,000 tickets.
Yeah.
I mean, it was absurd, but the city, everybody was having a good time, and I was like, hey, you do your Grateful Dead thing. It was cool. And a lot of contact highs to be had on public transit these last few days. But, like, what do you do in those moments where you then find out years later that some of these things that were rumored to be true and people rejected were actually true?
Well, I mean, if you're able to hold the, the conspirators to the fire, then you do it. You know, you can't expose everything. There are conspiracies probably going on now that we don't know about, that we might find out about in a few years. Maybe some of them we'll never find out about. So I don't take the position that conspiracies don't happen. They do, and they happen quite regularly, but they're not the norm. You know, most of government and most corporations run things. You know, they're normal people just like you and me, and they do the best job they can. But occasionally you'll have some evil people come along and do evil things. Okay, I don't argue that at all.
That's right.
Yeah, in a few years' time, some things, you know, we'll find out were the product of conspiracy. Maybe we will catch the guy that shot JFK. Maybe we will. Maybe we'll find the plane that didn't fly into the Pentagon.
It disappeared somewhere, and they took all the people out.
So maybe those things will come to light, and when they do, I hope we look at them with open eyes, and that's fine. But not every conspiracy theory that people believe in is going to turn out to be true.
I mean, that's a huge space for a huge letdown. You know, 2 huges there, wonderfully repetitive. Because what do you do in, you know, just incompetence or the banality of evil? That folks want a huge conspiracy, and the explanation for what happened is just so fundamentally simple. So I'll use 9/11 as an example. I was talking to a friend of the podcast who's been on a few times, Bill the Lizard, his nom de guerre, and we're talking about 9/11. Because Jesse the Body Ventura, and as I said, the conspiracy literature, and you go online, you can't read all of them. I mean, it's a fascinating alternative knowledge community. And the enthusiasm and the energy and the I'm sure you guys, the depth of belief and resistance to other facts is just so compelling to me as theater. So Jesse the Body Ventura, who I love as a professional wrestler and pro wrestling commentator, and his politics, I mean, are just visible to me, to quote Doctor Who, he's talking about 9/11. And he's coming up with some bizarre theory, recycling the stuff about the buildings and controlled demolitions. And now the new theory, I heard this several weeks ago, was that the government used some sort of microwave EMP weapon to bring down the buildings, and that's why you saw all this paper. Because paper wouldn't be destroyed by this weapon, but the buildings, the infrastructure would. I couldn't make sense of it. But it's so ridiculous and complicated, it's really hard to debunk because there's so many elements and so many moving parts very often. There's like, how the hell do you make sense of all this stuff?
In the book, we spend an entire chapter just on that question, is how can you test a conspiracy theory to see if it might be true or not? And the thing is, I think if you want to have some magic test that tells you true from false, you're not going to have it. At best, you're going to have some subjective tests that you can apply that might tell you if a conspiracy is probably true or probably false. You know, to us, to me and my co-author, we think every conspiracy theory has a better than 0% chance of being true. It's just where we place that percentage is going to vary by conspiracy theory, and of course it'll vary between the person evaluating. For instance, you might think about conspiracy theories in terms of how many people are involved in it. You know, let's put the EMP thing aside for a moment and take a theory that I'm a little bit more familiar with, and that's one where they planted explosives in the Twin Towers.
To bring them down.
Blew them up. Now, in order for that to be true, if you think through it, you'd have to have people go into the two busiest buildings on the planet, plant tons of explosives way up inside the building, then set them off at the exact time and the exact place that the planes are going to fly into. The planes have to fly in at the right time in the right place, which isn't necessarily that easy to do. So there are all these things that have to go right in order for that to work. And based on that, you might say, gosh, that's probably not true. But just on the same token, you might say, well, that theory makes more sense to me than 18 or 19 idiots hijacking some planes with box cutters and just pulling it off. You know, we always come back to the idea that just evaluation of evidence can be very subjective.
In the 18 or 19, you know, the box cutter example, like I said, you know, doing the end around here, when I mentioned earlier the idea of this banality of evil or just government incompetence, do you think, you know, again, this is a granular question, even though you're dealing with the huge macro-level stuff, I mean, and you do it wonderfully with your colleague in your book, do you think that conspiracy theories are a way, you know, a tool for folks just to make sense of the incomprehensible? Because rather than just pursue Occam's razor and the simplest explanation, you got to come up with something to our eyes, or perhaps to my eyes, or the listener's eyes, that's ridiculous in order to make sense of something that's just unfathomable?
One thing a lot of people have told me is that isn't it just that conspiracy theories are there to make sense of a dizzyingly complicated or random world?
Mm-hmm.
And my answer is no. No. And the reason is because conspiracy theories get far more complicated than the real world sometimes. I mean, some conspiracy theories, you just have so many moving parts and so many things going on and so many people involved that you just can't follow it anymore. And at that point, it's just like, if you're going to look for an explanation that's simple, just say 18 dudes with box cuts.
There you go.
That's the more simple explanation than most conspiracy theories out there.
And incompetence, part of the government and law enforcement. You know, and then that sort of gets to the heart of, again, thinking about legitimacy and how we assess the government. I was thinking another one that I just discovered a few months ago, actually, and maybe it's been around for some time. There's a new one about JFK that it wasn't Lee Harvey Oswald or outside conspirators or the Cubans or KGB, whoever, but it was one of the Secret Service agents behind him who slipped and fell and his AR-15 rifle accidentally discharged. Okay, wouldn't somebody have heard it? Wouldn't folks have seen it? Wouldn't they have, you know, when you check the weapon back in, be missing bullets? I mean, how the hell would you cover that one up?
Yeah, I watched that too. It was a pretty good documentary, and he made a compelling case with very anecdotal, very selective evidence. Here's what I say. It could be true. Mm-hmm. We just don't know. When I was in college, my political science professor told me her belief about it was that there wasn't a conspiracy to kill him. Oswald did it. But that JFK lived. And because they didn't have the 25th Amendment to the Constitution at the time, which would have transferred power over to Johnson, they had to pretend that he was dead in order to allow Johnson to assume the presidency. That's what I heard. Is there any evidence of that? No. Only anecdotal in the sense that a few years later they did pass the 25th Amendment, which made it possible to transfer power from an incapacitated president to the vice president.
And I was thinking, again, that's one of my favorite Weekly World News covers, is the aged JFK. And they purported, or their photographer got pictures of JFK and he's really alive. Or the other, my other favorite recent movie, I don't know if you've seen it, Bubba Hotep. And in that movie, so Elvis is alive and in a nursing home, and his assistant friend who fights the zombies in the nursing home is JFK. But what they did there, after he was shot, they dyed him black. They gave him medicine to change his melanin to make him into an African-American played by Ozzie Davis. So that's another fun one. But I mean, this is all serious stuff, but we're sitting here laughing and doing some storytelling. How does the role of just sort of like conspiracies and fun, you know, the fun of talking about these conspiracies has to give them life in a lot of ways, all right? Because, I mean, people go out and do research, they can talk, they have inside knowledge. I was talking to Jason Calavito, and he is a professional skeptic, and he does a lot of work on the ancient aliens phenomena on the History Channel, basically tearing every single episode apart. So he's immensely unpopular in those circles. And he was talking about how the ancient aliens and Bigfoot researchers were trying to have a conference. And his he's looking at the call for papers, and he started talking to these folks, and they wanted him to talk. And he's like, you have no standards of research or evidence, and you're starting from a false assumption that these phenomena are real. So he's like, how can you even have a serious conversation? Right, because he was telling me how the new thing in Bigfoot or cryptozoology and UFO studies is that Bigfoot is actually an alien or an interdimensional traveler. And he says to you and I, he's like, that's ridiculous. But he's like, it's a hell of a lot of fun for people to talk about. Do you think that's part of why this stuff is so compelling?
Yeah, I mean, there's a few things there in terms of entertainment. I mean, on my Facebook page, I mean, I get tons of stuff, you know, where people are writing about 10 craziest conspiracy theories, 5 kookiest conspiracy theories that turned out to be true. So people love to write about this stuff, and people love to read it. And there is entertainment value there. I mean, it is fun. And that's separate from believing in it. So people like looking at them sort of like they're zoo animals, right? Like, they won't necessarily believe in the conspiracy, but they enjoy hearing about them and talking about them because they're really cool. And they can definitely be a lot of fun. And then you have people who believe in them, who enjoy it, and they're attracted to these sorts of explanations, be they conspiratorial, and sometimes that will mix in with paranormal or mystical beliefs. So, I mean, you brought up Bigfoot. And the most interesting thing, Animal Planet, what are the most popular shows on Animal Planet? They're not about real animals. They're about fake animals. Mermaids that have been hidden from us by a Navy conspiracy. The U.S. Navy is hiding mermaid evidence. And I think Bigfoot is the other one. Those are like the biggest animal shows out there. But people love it. They eat it up. History Channel. Half of the history on the History Channel is not real.
I don't know, we're dating ourselves, because I know I remember when the History Channel actually used to try to show real history. You know, it's, now you turn it on, it's ancient aliens, horrible TV shows, revisionist stuff about the Old West and Texas. And you're like, where's the meat of the subject? Maybe it's, man, the H2 network is totally all that nonsense, isn't it?
I mean, I remember back about 15 years ago on the History Channel, could have been called the Nazi Channel, because all they did was Hitler and the Nazis, or Hitler's secret weapon, or Hitler's crazy generals. And so it was mostly World War II, and then I think they just switched from that to mysticism and paranormal and that sort of thing. I think people who are real history buffs might be upset with the direction they've taken.
Thought that was lingering. About, you know, you had the conference. I'm certainly going to go on and use Google Scholar and look up some of those great papers on conspiracy theories. Are there folks working, or others who publish on the topic, who have written about the Willie Lynch letter?
No. And in fact, I don't even know about it.
So the Willie Lynch letter is one of the most enduring conspiracy theories among the African-American community. And the Willie Lynch letter argues, I can sort of tell you about my own debunking of it with the help of a mentor when I was in college, but you can go to any barbershop, hair salon, bar, sporting event, any place in the African-American community and probably ask somebody about this. Young, old, middle-aged. And it is a letter that purports to explain, written in the 1700s, how to destroy the black community and how to create a situation of violence, rivalry, independence. And apparently it's written by a slave owner and with notes from his overseer about how to control and break slaves. And the theory is that these principles are still at use, and they still describe the diverse and very often negative life outcomes across the color line in the United States. And if you stop somebody and say that is ridiculous, there's no evidence for such a letter, people become angry, hostile. And I remember when I first discovered it when I was in college, one of my mentors was a professor of the American South and the Caribbean. And I mentioned it in a class I was taking on Brazil and slavery in the Caribbean. I was like, well, what about the Willie Lynch letter? And he's sort of older, gruff gentleman. He's still alive. He must damn near be 95 years old and looks the same. And he's like, Chauncey, what is this letter you're talking about? I've never heard about this. And I was like, well, there's this letter that was written by a slave owner in the Caribbean, and it describes how to control black people and through slavery, and it's still applied today. So we print out a copy of the letter. I get him a copy of it off the, you know, then sort of nascent young internet, print it out. And he's like, I'm going to show you what historians do. He's like, we're going to meet tomorrow, and we're going to go through this letter. And we went line by line, and he pointed out all this stuff. Well, the language was wrong. The space, like the plantation was supposed to be at. And he's like, well, you know, we actually have maps, and we have journals, and we have evidence from this time period. Let's look up this guy. The person didn't exist. The rivers were wrong. Every part of it made no sense. And he said it suggests to him that it was written in the 1960s, right? To solve sort of thinking about, you know, black nationalism, black cultural nationalism, and it described a problem about the color line and then grounded it in the past so that folks would have some sort of sense of trajectory or ownership. Now they can do something because they've discovered the secret Willie Lynch letter. But it was so compelling, and so many people still believe it. It really, really is one of the greatest conspiracy theories of all time in this country.
Yeah, I mean, it's not one that I've heard of, but it seems very similar to the protocols of
The Elders
Zion. Zion. You know, another one that comes to mind is Saul Alinsky. Liberals do anything, and Glenn Beck says, oh, it's right from the Alinsky playbook. You know, they planned out what they were going to do years ago. Yeah, these things come, and they stay for a long, you know, long, long time. You know, if you're a conservative, you know, I guarantee that in that community they have their own conspiracy theories, and liberals have their own conspiracy theories that say how the right is going to get them, and mm-hmm. blacks have one that say how the whites are going to get them, and whites have one that say the blacks are going to get them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you think of us as a pluralistic society where you have a whole bunch of different groups, you know, fighting for stuff.
Resources.
Yeah. You're going to have this, you know, particularly in a free society. You know, the price of liberty is eternal paranoia.
I love that quote. That's T-shirt quotable or a bumper sticker. So two closing questions before we obviously talk about, you know, where we can find the book online, how folks can reach out to you. So if I had a, let's say hypothetically this hasn't happened, because who knows, maybe you're part of the, as you said, the cabal, the 1%, the global plutocrats, or the PR industry, or who knows, the shadow government. Let's say somebody showed up with a backpack full of money, and they said, you know what, Joe, we want you to consult with us about creating the greatest conspiracy of all time. We'll fill in the dots. We'll fill in the blanks, rather. But what would be the broad strokes that we need to have a compelling, believable conspiracy that would circulate and get traction?
So we actually have a section in the book, in the last chapter, that says if you want to become a, you know, successful conspiracy theorist and you want to make up conspiracy theories for profit, you know, here's what you do. You know, so if you want to attract a following, the big advice I can give you is to blame the biggest enemies that everybody already doesn't like. And don't divide your audience up. So I'll give you a really good example of this. There's a guy named David Icke.
The reptile people, right?
Made a little bit of money and sold a lot of books about how reptiles rule the planet and that the British monarchy and all the U.S. presidents are all descendant of some reptilian bloodline. Now, you know, he sold books, but he wasn't famous, and he wasn't getting rich off this. He was making some money. He had a very small cult following. A couple years back, he switched his conspiracy theory. So then he left lizard people kind of off the table and said, you know, very simply, it's the big political parties, it's the big corporations. They're the ones that we need to point the finger at. It's the governments and the parties and the corporations. And you know who can get behind that message? Everybody. Everybody.
So that's, it's hardly a revolutionary thought. I mean, it's rather uninteresting because it's so obvious.
Yeah, and in that summer on Twitter, I think he raised $2.5 million.
Wow.
Just by pushing that message. And it's a very banal message. But he tapped into, it's essentially like, it's like when a music group sells out. It's where you're no longer playing music for your crowd, but instead trying to play the hit, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you're trying to mass market. And that's essentially what he did by blaming those big groups that everybody already hates. But if you want to become a successful conspiracy theorist, I mean, the easiest route, not to say it's the Republicans, You know, they're the ones behind everything. Because then you're not going to have any Republicans following
That's
you.
Right. If you said, but if you're vague and say the power elite or big government or our shared enemies or whoever it may be.
That's exactly what you do. And that's where you will get the big following.
An enemy we can all get behind. What about being sufficiently vague? Is it better to be vague or super, 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 super specific about things that may or may not be true? Or some mix of the two? Or
you could do both. I mean, both. I mean, specifics can be really fun, but it's the more specific you get, the more you can be disproven.
Mm-hmm.
So you always want to leave yourself enough room to move the goalposts.
Enough wiggle room. And a shared issue of common concern. It sounds like propaganda 101. Right, it really is.
And it's not that much different than, say, running just a regular political campaign. You know, look what our all of our candidates are going to talk about. You know, Washington's gone wrong for too long. It's the big politicians and the lobbyists and the special interests. And they're all going to say the same thing. And they're all going to blame these people that we can all blame and get mad at. You know, so this strategy isn't all that new. So.
I mean, it's emotional appeals and symbolic politics for low information voters.
Yeah. So,
I mean, that's the hustle.
It's just a lot of people would go into, make up a conspiracy theory. A lot of people would believe it and they'd start coming up with something crazy and weird, but no one's going to buy into that. They're going to buy into the simple, vague stuff where you blame things they already hate.
As a concluding question, because I just have to ask it given the topic, because I can only imagine, and maybe I'm just absolutely wrong, or maybe you have some great filters on your email. What are some of the phone calls and email requests that you get that are either just disturbing, fascinating, or fun? Because I could have to imagine, you're working on conspiracy theories, you must get some bizarre inquiries.
I've been lucky. I mean, there are some scholars who do work on this who get just really harassed. And we've had issues where journal articles have been retracted by the editors because of threat of lawsuits from conspiracy theorists. So conspiracy theorists sometimes don't like being studied.
What would be the legal basis? They just don't want to fight it and waste the money, so they pull the article?
I don't want to sound like a conspiracy theorist, but I have inside information, can't talk about it.
There you go. Isn't it fun in life to at least be able to say that once?
Yeah.
You feel like you're a party to a conspiracy and you have all this information. It's like you ask somebody about an alien, or I have a friend of mine, he's since retired, but he did a lot of covert work in the 90s and early 2000s. And I always try to ask him about stuff, and he was in the U.S. Navy, and he's like, I can't tell you.
Yeah.
I'm sure he's just saying it's like his standard response for fun, but he's like, really, there's some stuff I can't tell you. So that's always, I've not had that moment in my life yet.
Yeah, well, in this case, I have nothing nefarious going on, just personal confidence.
So we will deflect that one, and we'll throw that one out to the audience.
But I will tell you this. You mentioned Coast to Coast. I did Coast to Coast one night.
Oh, wow.
And I had to come into my office to do it because I had to use the landline here, and it was the interview was, I think, 1 a.m. to 4 a.m. in the morning. So I was here by myself on campus. It was creepy to begin with. And as I was doing the show, I mean, Coast to Coast is kind of a, you know, it's creepy. You know, I listened to it, but because it's creepy.
Who was the host, George Norrie or somebody else?
Yeah, it was George. I just started getting, once I went live, I just started getting tons of emails that were, one was just weirder than the next. And I got 10 emails from one woman asking me to walk into the light with her. And
where's the light at? Is it down the street?
I couldn't quite tell. And then I got another one from a nice lady that said Michelle Obama and Madonna were conspiring against her, and the FBI hasn't let her leave her house in 10 years because she owns the copyrights to all of Madonna's songs, but Michelle Obama won't let her collect the money. So maybe it's true.
What were some of the questions you got on the show? Because I've never met someone who's been on the show. I mean, were they sort of boilerplate stuff? Were some really, really specific? Because that show over the years, I mean, I prefer Art Bell, who doesn't. And Norrie is who he is. And he's trying to do his best. But some of the listeners are very literate and very smart, on point in terms of the types of questions and their knowledge of sort of these alternative belief systems. And, of course, you have the crazy questions, too. They're like, okay, this person needs a little help. I mean, what were some of the questions that you got, the smart ones or the most, you know, compelling or fascinating that you recall?
They were all normal. And I think they might have been screening pretty well that night.
Mm-hmm.
But there was nothing that really went off the rails. It was just the emails I was getting on the side that went off a little bit. I mean, there was one. It wasn't on Coast to Coast, but I did a bunch of radio to support the book, and I did a radio station in Central Florida, so out in cow country. And I did a morning program, and they didn't have a call screener. And the first, they had me on, we talked a little bit about the book, it was a very nice conversation, and then the first caller was, you know, what about those Jews trying to conspire to get us good white people? What about the protocols of Zion that say this is all true? It's like, good morning, Florida. So occasionally I do get some stuff like that, and you have to tell the person. You know, it puts me in an awkward position because, you know, I try to say that every conspiracy theory has a better than 0% probability of being true. You know, so I never want to tell anyone, no, that's absolutely false, because that's just not what I do. But in some cases where you have conspiracy theories that could potentially lead to violence or
and have led to violence.
Or extremism, yeah, you got to be like, no, that's false, and move on, you know?
I mean, the protocols of the Elders of Zion have had such staying power. I mean, we can talk about, at least in the United States, the decline of anti-Semitism, although it's still very much present, never mind in Europe and other parts of the world. But the protocols of the Elders of Zion, I mean, I've been in the classes, I've actually had students mention it and cite it as though it's the truth. But as you said, sometimes you just have to say no.
Yeah.
This is absurd, and I'll tell you why. And I'll tell you why it's not true. You know, then my follow-up question is, where are you being exposed to this? Is it in the home? Is it online in the internet? Is it cyber racism? Why are you including this in your cognitive schema for making sense of the world?
Yeah, in a sense, you're doing the right thing, but you know, to me, it's almost like, I always wonder how much impact I'm going to have on people. You know, I can't get kids to do their homework. So
how can I dissuade them?
Yeah, how am I going to change something they believe to be true for 20 years, you know?
So what are the future projects, and where can folks find you online? Good, exciting stuff in the future.
I am at joeuscinski.com, and the book is American Conspiracy Theories, available in both ebook format and paperback on Amazon.com. I'm at the University of Miami. I am tenured, so I'll probably be here forever. And my future work is going to be, you know, just on this, looking at conspiracy theories, why they might or might not be true, who believes in them, and what gets people to believe in them or not believe in them. And it's a fun topic, and if your audience is interested in it, I highly recommend the book.
By all means, as I said, you know, and certainly your students. I mean, are you teaching courses, I would imagine, on conspiracy theories? I mean, how are the students responding to
it? Yeah, I've taught a class on this for the last 4 years. It sells out on the first day of registration, so the class is always packed. Students love it. They eat it up. It's a very fascinating topic. For them, one of the projects we do in class is I have them make up their own conspiracy theory, and then they trade it with another student, and the other student has to debunk it. And what I always find is that's so fascinating is that the student who wrote the conspiracy theory gets offended when the other person debunks it.
They've already invested in their
name. Yeah, they've invested in it. But I'm like, but you know it's not true. You made it up. They're like, well.
This is my creative life force and lifeblood, and it's coming from somewhere within me. So Joe, I just want to thank you for being so generous with your time and sitting down on the podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show, our virtual salon, to talk about conspiracy theories and Hofstadter and legitimacy and government and all that good stuff.
Thank you so much for having me. It was a lot of fun.
I want to thank our guest one more time for just taking so much of his time to sit down and share and chat about his work on conspiracy theories, and just like I said, alternative knowledge systems. How do you decide what the evidence suggests is true? I love his little quip where he says, you know, he and his co-author work from the assumption that every conspiracy theory has a better than 0% chance of being true. I mean, what a nice sort of academic intellectual wink, wink, if not diss. I like that. Sort of saying, okay, we'll assume there's some possibility that this exists. And again, some conspiracies are really, 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 really dangerous. Protocols of the Elders of Zion, for example. Thinking about conspiracies that are real. Tuskegee syphilis experiment. Kill people. Made them to suffer. Willie Lynch, we've talked about that. There's some papers to be written there. You want to talk about a fantastical theory. No basis in truth or evidence. But it resonates even till the present because it describes how folks who are racially marginalized in a society that's structured around white privilege, where people of color, especially black Americans, have been subjected to conspiracies in many ways. So good sharing. As I said, I love talking to people who have taken the time to develop the empirical tools and the data to intervene in common sense conversations, and I put common sense in quotation marks, that often don't get the critical scrutiny they desire or deserve. So again, thanks to Joe. That was just really good. So conspiracy theories can also be a lot of fun because you got to, like I said, growing up on Weekly World News, growing up on Art Bell, growing up talking, as I shared in the conversation with Joe, Dr. Uscinski, with former Black Panthers who actually witnessed and were part of COINTELPRO. They know about a state that turns against its citizens, puts them against one another, infiltrates real false flags, kills people, Talk about the paranoia that must have engendered, because this brother had seen so much. And you would say, he's paranoid and crazy. Yeah, but it ain't paranoia if they're really after you. So thinking back to some of the other conspiracies, right? So, of course, the moon landings are fake, JFK, 9/11 was an inside job. What are some other good ones? People conspiring to cover up cryptids like Loch Ness and Bigfoot. Maybe there's, you know, the people living in the center of the earth. Maybe Atlantis was real. Well, Atlantis was real, actually. That was an island off of Crete, I believe. What's another good one? Pearl Harbor, that the Brits and others knew, and FDR knew, and he allowed the U.S. to be attacked on Pearl Harbor in order to give us the impetus and motive for war. Well, it really didn't need to have Pearl Harbor to respond to the Japanese. The wheels were already in motion there. But so many good ones because, again, they try to make the unknowable known. They try to explain tragic and challenging events. And it's a nice way for some to make sense of the world. The question is, what do they do with it? What sort of actions do they take in the political or public sphere of their personal lives in response to that conspiracy theory? So one of my favorite conspiracy theories, there's several. There's a really cool book called I Heard It Through the Grapevine. You should check out. I think it's still in print. And it's about conspiracy theories, race, and rumor in the African-American community. And so much of it revolves around the color line and power. So, stretching as I get ready to put my reading voice, and you guys may remember this one. There was a conspiracy, rumor and conspiracy, in the 1990s around Snapple Ice. Do you remember that one? That Snapple had KKK members on it, and they were taking the money from the black community to finance eugenics or exterminating black people through Snapple. I remember this because I was a Snapple fiend when that came out. Another conspiracy at the time, we had Church's Fried Chicken. Remember that when they were putting saltpeter into the church's chicken to make black men sterile? Remember that one? That was a good one too. I have friends be like, I ain't going to churches. They gonna keep me from reproducing, keep me as a black man, a god, and a god from spreading his seed with his queens. I had Universal Zulu Nation brothers and friends who were really deep into that 5% stuff. They would actually recite all that rhetoric. And I'd be like, man, I don't like churches. I like Popeyes. So another good one was Tropical Fantasy Punch. It was a beverage distributed in the New York area. I don't know if it made it out of New York to LA or Chicago. And there is a rumor that it was some sort of poisonous cocktail that was targeting black people, and it was marketed by the Klan, apparently, to cause sterility. So Snopes, I was looking up some stuff. I said, we were talking serious stuff on this anniversary episode of 9/11. My birthday week, my birthday forever ruined by that heinous, thuggish attack. That's my narcissism. Allow me, indulge Chauncey DeVega on his birthday while he will be 36, 37 forever as he decides if he's going to dye his hair or not. That Tropical Fantasy had all these rumors around it. So Snopes, to their credit, great website, went and did some research on this one. And they rated this rumor false. And I'll just read a few of this stuff. Because sometimes you got to laugh to keep him crying on this week. For a lot of folks, very tragically painful memories. Painful, painful, painful memories. And a lot of loss. A lot of loss. From Snopes, here's the setup. Origins. Tropical Fantasy was brought onto the market in September 1990 by Brooklyn Bottling, a small family-owned soft drink manufacturer established in 1937 that was in 1990 only just getting by in its line of seltzers. I love a good seltzer, by the way. Fantasy's comparably low price, 49 cents per 20-ounce bottle, versus Coke and Pepsi's 80 cents price. Man, remember 80 cents for a soda? Damn. For a 16-ouncer led to a stunning initial success, and overnight a moribund firm became a bottler now with per-month sales of $2 million plus. In April 1991, rumors began circulating in black neighborhoods that the beverage was laced with a secret ingredient that could cause sterility in black men, and that the Ku Klux Klan were the actual bottlers. Sales of the beverage plummeted by 70%. Now, this begs some questions. What is a secret ingredient that would cause sterility in black men? I mean, the science here is baffling. We got to figure this one out. Maybe the folks who put out that propaganda trash, that Myoffa 21 movie, and who blame Margaret Sanger, says she's an anti-black eugenicist, can come up with the chemistry behind this. Maybe we'll ask Ben Carson. He's been embarrassing himself. Maybe he knows about the secret ingredient that causes black sterility. So, as I said, sales of the beverage plummeted by 70%. The rumor did not spread by word of mouth alone. Someone took the time to type it up and see that it was widely distributed via a flyer posted in stores and passed hand to hand. Attention, attention. Attention, three attentions, 50 cent sodas, blacks and minority groups, did you see TV show 2020? Please be advised, I'm reading that, it literally says please be advised. Top Pop and Tropical Fantasy 50 cent sodas are being manufactured by the Ku Klux Klan. Sodas contain stimulants to sterilize the black man and who knows what else. They are only put in stores in Harlem and minority areas. You won't find them downtown. Look around. You have been warned. Please save the children.
So Snopes continues, two aspects of tropical fantasy's marketing contributed to the belief that the drink would provide an excellent vehicle to slip a noxious substance to African Americans, where the beverage was being sold in the product name itself. Most of the retail outlets vending the drink were located in the inner city areas densely populated by African Americans, or densely populated with African Americans. There were no marketing campaigns other than store displays, a practice which rendered the product almost invisible to consumers not living in such areas. And the tropical portion of the name led some to believe that these fruit-flavored drinks were from the tropics, the place of origin of any number of the targeted consumers, and thus appealed more strongly to non-whites. Brooklyn Bottling's early attempts to fight the rumor were unsuccessful. Consumers were not swayed by the information that the same ridiculous slander had been aired about Church's fried chicken only a few years earlier. And this part is just sad. The manufacturer fought harder and hired a black PR firm to advise on how to diffuse the talk. Folks were hired to drive trucks. I vaguely remember this. Trucks displaying large billboards denying the allegations around black neighborhoods. The drink was also submitted to the FDA for testing, and the results were made public. Brooklyn Bottling employees were sent into affected areas to distribute quote-unquote truth flyers to dispel the rumor. The New York City Health Department declared the soda safe. KKK Imperial Wizard James Farrens was prodded into saying the Ku Klux Klan is not in the bottling business. Ah, oh, these poor people. Entrepreneurs trying to make a buck selling black people diabetes and inducing and causing beverages. Isn't this America? Can't we be free to be poisoned as I look at my Coca-Cola? Problems continued. Distributors were threatened with baseball bats and delivery drivers were pelted with bottles. Rumors then began to circulate that Pepsi and Coca-Cola officials were deliberately spreading the rumor to regain inner-city market shares, whispers that were denied by representatives of both companies. Free tropical fantasy was handed out. The warmer weather also worked its magic, creating increased demand for cold beverages. And here is the money shot. New York Mayor David Dinkins, a prominent African-American, drank tropical fantasy on television in an effort to prove it was harmless. The combined counterattacks finally took the wind out of the rumor, and by mid-June 91, sales had rebounded. The rumor was not necessarily forgotten, but it was no longer strongly influencing sales. Well, goodness gracious. We don't know who started it, and this is on Snopes. You just go to Snopes, racial/business tropical, you get the rest of the story. But what are some rumors that you believe? Because I said, I don't think the soda is directly targeting black and brown people. I just think it's cheap and it's poison and people trying to save money and they're killing themselves. And there's no conspiracies. It's a conspiracy of economics. And people have habituated themselves to drinking crappy stuff and eating bad food in part because they're poor. They live in food deserts. The only place to go is a corner bodega in McDonald's. That's what's killing them. It's a conspiracy of poverty and bad diet and addiction to sugar. That's what's killing folks. But it does, like you say, you know, conspiracy theories really are, and Joe Uscinski and I talk about this. You know, as I said, that great book, check it out. I heard it through the grapevine, talks about this. Groups who are marginalized and oppressed, you know what? They got good reason to be scared. They got good reasons to buy into certain conspiracy theories because that conspiracy theory may likely be true, and it's a means of survival. When you live in a world where people are actually out to get you, yeah, you better err on the side of caution. So that is our lighthearted conspiracy on this September 11th week. So next episode, good show for folks who are interested in conspiracy theories, who have listened to Art Bell, Coast to Coast AM, or just curious about alternative knowledge systems, myth and folklore, charismatic belief systems, religion. The next guest is Dr. David Frankfurter. He's the author of the great, I mean, smart and troubling and provocative book. By the way, you're interested in anthropology, religious studies. Evil Incarnate, Rumors of Demonic Conspiracy and Satanic Abuse in History. So again, you know my ghetto nerd bona fides or bona fides. Weekly World News, Art Bell, reading books by the late Malachi Martin, who was one of the official exorcists for the Vatican. Very curious about parapsychology. And you caught my joke. If you watched Ring of Fire, I had a little slip there where I was trying to say political pathology or psychopathy. And then I ended up saying parapsychology, got Ghostbusters on the brain. Well, when I heard about this book in Reddit, I was like, I got to have Dr. Frankfurter on. And that's the wonderful marvel of the internet. You send an email, you ask somebody nicely, and folks very well may say yes. So he is a professor with expertise in religious studies, anthropology, antiquity, the Bible, other Abrahamic faiths. He's traveled all over the world. And some of the stories about exorcism are just really, really fascinating. And he and I have a good to and fro about the idea of metaphysics, about science, about faith. And I started off because he and I chatted right around
maybe a few weeks after that horrible white racial terrorist Dylan Roof killed all those folks in that church. And I was thinking aloud, we say people are evil. What do we mean? Is that phrase overused? Dylan Roof was evil. Well, is he evil? How do we define it? How do we understand what evil is? Is it something we see? Is it an absence of good? That's how the sort of the solution in my intro religious studies class was presented to me about theodicy, the problem of evil and an all-knowing, all-good God. And we just pivot from there. As I said, we talk about his travels as a child, some of the things he witnessed, his work on the Bible and faith, discussions of witchcraft, and the witch trials in the U.S. and Europe and elsewhere, and again, little understood that the victims, the women and some men, who were killed by these moral panics, or because of these moral panics, had land that people wanted. Many of them were outsiders. Many of them were midwives, people who were just different. And you have this construct of hysterical religiosity. You know, my opinion about religion, I'm an atheist that believes in God. But this sort of fundamentalist hysteria and how religion can damage the minds of people and drive them to madness. And again, you know, HBO and Vice, I think, had a special on this. These exorcisms that you're seeing in Africa, where they're killing people. Never mind our gay and lesbian queer brothers and sisters in this country, where they have these exorcisms as though somebody's humanity is something evil to be exorcised, a lust demon. And I have talked to people who believe in this stuff, that there are lust demons. Nothing more tragic than a gay man who's in denial about his sexuality, who grew up in the black church, believing in lust demons. I was like, man, if there's a lust demon, you need to get it in your lap and understand and grapple with your humanity and desires. Because the worst thing you can do through religion or other means is to give people guilt about their sexuality, heterosexual, homosexual, other. And I've encountered too many people, women and men, who have religious guilt about their sexuality and their humanity. It just makes me sad. I think that's parental misconduct. I think that's a type of abuse, actually, to do that to kids. Again, thanking our great guest, Joe Uscinski, Dr. Uscinski, one more time for sitting at the virtual bar and having a good to and fro, a nice little back and forth about conspiracy theories and American politics, political psychology. You know my standard closer. Oh, my Herbert the Perfect voice almost slipped out there. Bill the Lizard, we're looking for you. When are you going to come around so we can give you a hug? Folks know Bill the Lizard's one of the friends of the podcast. Bill, are you on a secret mission? Are you over there in Iran? Are you having your own Desert One? Have you been captured and need a hug? I love that Herbert the Pervert from Family Guy. You can do anything with Herbert the Pervert. You really can. He should start campaigning for Donald Trump. You see, I can't go 1 week without mentioning that thug. Talk about performance art, but it's deadly serious performance art. So as is my standard closer, if you can, are willing, are able, have the resources, producing the once a week eponymously named podcast, Mr. Chauncey DeVega Show, takes time, energy, resources, opportunity costs. So if you can throw some pennies, ducats, silver, paper into that PayPal link on the right-hand side of the screen over at chaunceydevega.com, that will be very, very much appreciated. And as always, I want to thank all the folks who subscribe to the podcast, who actually on a monthly basis throw some change into that PayPal link. That means a lot. I want to thank the folks who donated to Chauncey DeVega's Mama's Washing Machine Fund. That's very much appreciated, too. I'm going to tell her all that you sent some change over, and we're going to get that washing machine so she doesn't have to keep going to the laundromat and complaining to me every day. It'll make me go even more gray than I am. And the second part of my standard closer, so we got the little fundraising appeal. You always got to do that fundraiser. You always got to say, hey, you got some change. Show us some love if you can. And if you can't, send positive energy. It's hard out there. Take care of your family. Take care of your animal friends. Take care of your own immediate needs. And if you got that dollar left over, show a brother some love. So, once again, if you can, please be kind and be good. It's not if you can, it's a commandment. Commandment, that's what it's a commandment. It's a golden rule. Do unto others as you like them to do unto you, and do good to people. So the positive energy will come back around for all of us, because that really is important in this time of trouble, these times of travails and difficulty. Be good to each other. So please be kind to one another. Please be generous to our homeless brothers and sisters and my residence folks who are struggling to stay off these streets. You got a lot of people living in cars. Scary times out there. A lot of struggle. Please try to help those folks. When you see our homeless brothers and sisters, if you can't give them money or food, at least acknowledge people's humanity and make eye contact and nod your head and talk to people. That's very important. That human contact is very, very, very important. Please be kind and good to our four-legged, winged, reptilian, cat, canine, bird, doggy. I know I said canine and dog twice. That's okay. Friends, our reptilian friends, our birdie friends, our squirrel friends, all the nature, all the little animals, and my spider friend is still here, and she's doing a good job. We had to renegotiate our treaty, but she's back to taking care of the little gnats and bugs that like to bite me in my turned over Jawa Sandcrawler overpriced Chicago apartment. As I say, if you had any idea of the hell, the struggle dealing with these loud buses and heat and no air conditioning. I'm struggling, baby, but I'm here for you. I'm here for you. So please try to take care of our animal friends. And again, if you have someone in your life, a friend, someone you've had a falling out with, a relative you've had a fight with, someone that you just lost touch with over the years, pick up that phone or send over that email or even a text. Try to reopen that communication. That's so very important because life is too short. Live every day to the fullest because you don't know when you're going, that bell's going to ring and you're going to get called home, as they say. So just try to do that. And as always, please take care of yourself. Practice mental and emotional self-care. Watch after your own health and try to take care of yourself. Go for a walk. Meditate, exercise, stretch. But in all, try to take care of yourselves and try to take care of the people that are around you that care about you. And I appreciate all of you and your kindness and generosity and good energy that you have sent me over the years as I reflect on this year, my birthday week, and all the interesting happenings, both good and bad, of this year. More good than bad. I don't like to dwell on the bad. But keep sending Chauncey. Send Chauncey some birthday energy, please. Wish me well. Include me in your prayers if you could. Or your meditations. Send a brother some love. Because I believe in that. May not be religious, but I do believe in the collective subconscious. And that we're all tied together. So, my hand to your hand. Your hand to my hand, as they say. Like Dusty Rhodes cutting a promo. Talking through that TV screen. So, until next week, when we deal and confront the matter and topic of evil in this world. And the questions of faith and religion and demonic possession. I'm telling you, you're going to have to hold on to your seat for next week's conversation. Because it's a good one. It's a little scary. I don't know if you want to have the kids nearby. They may get scared hearing a smart man, an anthropologist, philosopher, expert in antiquity, talk about some of the things he's seen and how do you reconcile your intellectual work with the matters and experiences you've had and things you've seen that are not easily reconcilable. But it's a really, really great conversation. And I'm so glad that I had the opportunity to participate in it. So until next week, which won't be my birthday week. Dang it. Until next week, I want to thank you all for downloading, listening to, tweeting, and sharing the Chauncey DeVega Show. Be well and be safe.